hi friends, I'm Nagajyoti, working as assistant professor in St. Peter's Engineering College. So in the last session, we have discussed about read-only memory. Now, let us start how the random access memory is going to be worked and what are the different types of random access memory. So as we know that the random access memory will perform two different functions. One is read operation and the other one is write operation. So let us start how the reading operation of a RAM will take place. Now I am assuming here the CPU clock frequency is of 50 megahertz and each cycle time is 20 nanoseconds. In order to perform read operation, the memory access time required over here is 65 nanoseconds. And in order to perform either a read operation or a write operation, a minimum 4 machine cycles are required. Because before performing the read operation, first it need to select which memory location it need to perform the read operation. So in order to select the memory location, first of all it need to know what is the address code. So the first line is address, whichever the address which we are specifying through the address lines, that is pointed by using an address lines. As we are performing here a read operation, this read by write bar should be high. If read by write bar is equivalent to high, that itself indicates we are performing a read operation. And this memory enable pin also should be is equivalent to 1. If it satisfies both these conditions, that is memory enable equal to 1 and R by D bar is equivalent to 1, then only it is performing read operation. Whichever the address which has been pointed out by the address bus will be taken into the data and that will be given as a data valid after completion of 4 clock cycles. The next operation is a writing operation. So the general size of a RAM is 2 power k by n. K are the number of address lines and n is the data output, and along with the chip select and output enable, it consists of other more control signal which is called as RD by W bar or R by W bar. So in order to perform writing operation, it need to follow some steps. The first step is we need to make this chip select should be equivalent to 1. When chip select is equivalent to 1, that itself indicates it is performing enabling the operation. And the next is we need to perform write operation. So in order to perform write operation, RD by W bar should be equivalent to 0. And the third one is we need to select the address where we need to perform a write operation. And the last one is send the word to store that to the either to the data in or data out. So this is a timing diagram for writing operation. So in case of this writing operation, if we observe the previous one and this one, the only difference over here is memory enable is same, which is equivalent to high, but R by D bar should be is equivalent to low, because here we are performing a writing operation. Whether we are performing a reading operation or a writing operation, we need of minimum of 4 machine cycles in order to complete one operation. So as we know that these RAMs are of two types, one is static RAM and the other one is dynamic RAM. So in case of the static RAM, in order to design a static RAM, we need to use one latch for each bit of storage. So why we are using a latch but not a flip-flop? In case of a latch, we'll be using two NAND gates or two NOR gates. But A flip-flop requires at least twice that of the hardware which can be used by the latch. So if the hardware is small, the operation will be faster and it requires less power and the cost is also less. So in order to trade off between these things, instead of using a flip-flop, here we'll be using a latch in case of a static RAM. So this is a basic structure of a static RAM with a SR latch. So in case of a SR latch, we'll be using either a NAND gates or a NOR gates, depending upon the type of the clock signals which we are using. This how can we can design a RAM structure. And this is a RAM bit slice model. In the previous slide, we are able to perform either read operation or write operation for a single bit. Here we can perform for more than one bit, where we'll be using three SR latches and we are designing a RAM structure by using a slice model. This is 8x2 RAM using 4x4 RAM cell array. So here 4x4 itself indicates it consists of 4 rows and 4 columns. So here we need to use a 2x4 decoder in which the inputs are 2 inputs A0 and A1. If both the inputs are 00, first row is selected. If it is 01, second row is selected. If it is 10, third row is selected. Similarly, if we want to select a column, at the bottom we are having other more 2x4 decoder which can be used in order to select a particular column. Whenever the intersection of this row and the column points a particular RAM cell, that has been pointed and you can perform either a read operation or a write operation. Let me take an example. The input, that is row decoder, is having 01. So the row decoder input is 01. That itself indicates first one is selected, that is second row is selected. Similarly, the bottom decoder, which is column decoder, is also 01. That itself indicates second column is selected. So the intersection of second row and the second column is nothing but fifth RAM cell. So you can perform the read operation or a write operation of only fifth RAM cell, because only fifth RAM is coincident with a row as well as column. This is how you can select a particular RAM cell by using row decoder as well as a column decoder. And these are the examples of SRAM devices which are available in the IC form. And the next is coming to the next type of RAM, which is nothing but a dynamic RAM. So this dynamic RAM is built with capacitors. So if there is charge in the capacitor, it represents a logic 1. If there is no charge on the capacitor, it represents 0. So as we know that the capacitor will lose its charge only after few milliseconds. So in case of a dynamic RAM, we require a refreshing circuit in order to store the data continuously. So the dynamic RAMs are physically smaller than the static RAMs, and a single bit of data can be stored with just one capacitor and one transistor. But whereas in case of a static RAM, if you want to store single bit of data, it requires minimum of 4 to 6 transistors. So the dynamic RAM is cheaper and denser, and more bits can be stored in the same physical area when compared to that of the SRAM. So this is the structure of a DRAM. In case of a DRAM, along with this one capacitor, we need of a refreshing circuit. So one transistor and one capacitor will be used as a DRAM. If the capacitor is charged, it represents a logic 1. If capacitor is discharged, it represents a logic 0. But if you want to perform a single bit of storage by using SRAM, we need of 6 transistors. So the SRAM cost is 3 times high than that of the DRAM. And the complexity of the SRAM is very high when compared to that of the DRAM. Cost per bit is less for DRAM because we are using only one transistor and one capacitor. And this is the DRAM bit slice in which we are using 2 D flip-flops and we are storing the data by using a DRAM. And this is the DRAM structure using including a refreshing circuit. That is, whenever the capacitor is losing its data, we need to perform a refresh operation at regular intervals of time. This is all about the RAM. Thank you.